Good morning. I'd like to welcome everyone to worship this morning. Glad we're all here and lively today. Have a few announcements to point out. So a couple of youth things that next Sunday, September 11th, there'll be a planning meeting. Would you like to say anything more about that?
Just plan to stay at your church. Everybody is welcome. We're going to have lunch. I'm going to talk to the youth a little bit about what's going on, and then after lunch we'll assemble school kits, and then after that we'll have ice cream sundaes. So everyone is welcome, but especially any of our kids to stay after for the youth meeting.
Okay.
I have a couple of announcements. The other one, I was realizing that because the town meeting here in town got moved to next Monday, with tomorrow being Labor Day, dinner discussion has been pushed back to September 19th. Instead of normally we have on the 12th, but I know probably Murray and Rick will be at the town meeting, so we'll have it on the 19th instead. That is in your bulletin. I brought back all the Wickman voices from our outdoor service last week, and I put them back in the pews where they are, and I'm pretty sure that I put our personal one into the pews, which has some guitar chords and stuff written in it. So, and now you guys are here in front, don't even bother. But you guys, if you have a chance, if you happen to see, like if you just kind of flip through your Wickman voice, if you happen to see guitar chords, if you just set it to the side, that would be helpful because, yes. Well, good. I didn't borrow that one from boys, so you're good to go. It's pretty much like the three pews on this side and the four pews on this side. So if you happen to see it, just set it to the side, and I'll get it later. Otherwise, I'll take some time later and scroll through those. But all right. And the last announcement I want to make is just for your information, this afternoon we'll be celebrating a wedding. Jessica Bertram, you know, Will's mom, who's been running around a lot. She and Alan Van Cura will be getting married in a small family service this afternoon here at St. Paul's. So if you happen to, like, see a lot of activity here, that's what's going on. You might see them before, as we're leaving Sunday school time, that they might be coming in. So, but we celebrate with them today on their wedding.
All right, do you have any other announcements this morning? Yes,
ma'am. I'm doing the newsletter this week, so if you've got anything, please send it to me or call me or something.
Okay. Very good. All right, then we'll begin our worship with our reporter for confession and forgiveness, found on page 10 or on the screen. The worship as we're baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us,
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Kyrie eleison, Lord have mercy.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray the prayer of the day. Direct us, O Lord God, in all our doings with your continual help, that in all our works begun, continued, and ended in you, we may glorify your holy name, and finally, by your mercy, bring us to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Our first reading today comes from Deuteronomy chapter 30, verses 15 to 20. See, I have set before you today life and prosperity, death and adversity, if you obey the commandments of the Lord your God that I am commanding you today, by loving the Lord your God, walking in his ways, and observing his commandments, decrees, and ordinances. Then you shall live and become numerous, and the Lord your God will bless you in the land that you are entering to possess. But if your heart turns away and you do not hear, but are led astray to bow down to other gods and serve them, I declare to you today that you shall perish. You shall not live long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today that I have set before you life and death, blessings and curses. Choose life so that you and your descendants may live, loving the Lord your God, obeying him, and holding fast to him. For that means life to you and length of days, so that you may live in the land that the Lord swore to give to your ancestors, to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Thus ends the first reading. Today's psalm is Psalm 1, and we shall read it responsively by whole verse. Happy are they who have not walked in the counsel of the wicked, nor lingered in the way of sinners, nor sat in the seats of the scornful. They are like trees planted by streams of water, bearing fruit in due season, with leaves that do not wither. Everything they do shall prosper.
It is not so with the wicked. They are like chaff which the wind blows away.
Therefore, the wicked shall not stand upright when judgment comes, nor the sinner in the counsel of the righteous. The second reading comes from the book of Philemon, verses 1 to 21. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother. To Philemon, our dear friend and co-worker, to Apphia, our sister, to Archippus, our fellow soldier, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. When I remember you in my prayers, I always thank my God because I hear of your love for all the saints and your faith toward the Lord Jesus. I pray that the sharing of your faith may become effective when you perceive all the good that we may do for Christ. I have indeed received much joy and encouragement from your love because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed through you, my brother. For this reason, though, I am bold enough in Christ to command you to do your duty. Yet I would rather appeal to you on the basis of love. And I, Paul, do this as an old man, and now also as a prisoner of Christ Jesus. I am appealing to you for my child, Onesimus, whose father I have become during my imprisonment. Formerly, he was useless to you. But now he is indeed useful both to you and to me. I am sending him, that is, my own heart, back to you. I wanted to keep him with me so that he might be of service to me in your place during my imprisonment for the gospel. But I preferred to do nothing without your consent in order that your good deed might be voluntary and not something forced. Perhaps this is the reason he was separated from you for a while, so that you might have him back forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. So if you consider me your partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. If he has wronged you in any way or owes you anything, charge that to my account. I, Paul, am writing this with my own hand. I will repay it. I say nothing about your owing me, even your own self. Yes, brother, let me have this benefit from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in Christ. Confident of your obedience, I am writing to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. Thus ends the second reading.
I invite kids to come forward for children's message. Well, good morning. How are you all doing today? Good. All right. Well, I have something in mind that I really want to do. I have a great idea. Okay? Are you ready? I might have had some great ideas like this before too. I want to build a tower out of blocks. You got a boo-boo right there. That's not fun. You'll probably get better though. I want to build a tower out of blocks, and I want to build it so high, I want to build it up as high as the roof of the church. Isn't that a great idea? I mean, that'd be awesome, wouldn't it? That'd be awesome. Well, I've got my blocks right here. You ready? Okay, here they are. All right. Think it's going to work? What's that? It's not, is it? Nope. I think that was a construction problem. Well, yeah, so now it's more sturdy. It's not taller. Nope. It's not. Oh, and it keeps falling over. But it's still, do you think it's going to make it? It's not taller. Nope. Okay, do you think, well, what's the problem? Why can't we build a tower tall enough to reach up there? Oh. That wouldn't be a tower, that would be a throw. And I think it's a losing chance there. Give it a try. I think the foundation is a little shaky. Okay. Why can't we build a tower all the way up to the ceiling? Ready? Why can't we build a tower all the way up to the ceiling?
Because
we don't have enough blocks. I should have thought of that, shouldn't I? If I wanted to build that tall, I would have needed a lot more blocks. Okay, well, that idea is not going to work. I have another great idea.
Yeah, I got it.
You got it. Sort of. Oh, that's gonna hurt. All right, let's pick those up and put them in here. Okay, well, I have another great idea. Oops. This great idea is... Okay, why don't you sit back up? Now this great idea is different than building a tower. I want to love everybody. I want to love everybody. Now that's a great idea, right? It is. Okay, so if I love everybody, now, but I ran out of blocks when I wanted to build the tower, I might have some problems if I try to love everybody. Like, it might take a lot of my time to love everybody. Huh. And what if I love everybody, that means maybe even loving people who don't like me. Well, that doesn't sound fun. Or if I'm going to love everybody, we're not doing that. If I'm trying to love everybody, I might, what if people made fun of me for that? Or said I should be spending my time otherwise. I could have problems. I could have trouble if I was trying to love everybody, couldn't I? But would I run out of love? No. I might feel sometimes a little bit tired, but I can't run out of love because God has enough love. Right? We ran out of blocks, but I couldn't run out of love. I might have some things where it might be hard. It might be hard, but I always have the love of God, don't I? I always have the fact that Jesus loves me, don't we? So it can be hard to try to love everybody the way that Jesus does. It can be kind of even scary to think, wow, everybody? That can be hard, maybe a little scary. But Jesus does it and he says, come on, I'll show you. You can do it too. We can't run out of love. We can run out of blocks, but we can't run out of love because Jesus' love is always enough for us and for the world. And so one step at a time, we can follow Jesus. We don't have to love everybody till the end of time all at once. We just one step at a time can try to follow Jesus and love people, love one another, and help one another following him. All right, let's pray together. Dear God, thank you that you love us so much that we can never run out of love. Help us to follow you and to love one another, even when that seems really hard, so we can really see what your love is all about. We pray all this and pray that you help us follow. In Jesus' name. Holy Gospel according to Luke, the 14th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Now, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and he turned and said to them, whoever comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and yes, even life itself, cannot be my disciple. Whoever does not carry the cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost, to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or what king, going out to wage war against another king, will not sit down first and consider whether he is able with 10,000 to oppose the one who comes against him with 20,000. If he cannot, then while the other is still far away, he sends a delegation and asks for the terms of peace. So therefore, none of you can become my disciples if you do not give up all your possessions. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I was talking to someone the other day about the Bible and about interpreting the Bible, about how there are so many voices over so much time and how things can seem to be in conflict at times, even within the Bible, how we can get different messages. I said that for me, a guiding principle is to always look at Jesus and who he is. After all, as we believe that he is the Word of God made flesh, and to use that to guide me when I look at, when I interpret other things, that shows me the way, shows me the center of what God is about, and that helps to guide me, to look at things through the lens of Jesus. Then I said, some people may think that sounds like a way to have things the way I want them to be, or it makes it, oh, always easy and rosy, and I said, that's not the case. When you look at things through the lens of Jesus, you know who Jesus is? Jesus said a lot of things that make my life harder, if I take them seriously. Said things that I really wish he didn't say, because I don't want to hear them. But he's Jesus, and so I need to hear them. So I was saying that the other day, and this is the gospel for today, and it's one of those days where Jesus says things, boy, did you have to say that, Jesus, okay, I guess I better listen to it, but makes me uncomfortable. That's always hard to know what to do with texts like this. One of those days where I wonder if I can preach on this because I don't hate my family. Sorry, Jesus, but good news, family. and I haven't given up all my possessions. So what am I going to say to you? I thought maybe just say, that's hard, I don't know what to do, and sit down. But maybe you want me to do that. But I'm going to try a little bit more than that. It's tempting to make it easier by explaining how Jesus didn't really mean that. And we could try to find ways to do that. But I think Jesus probably did mean what he said. Maybe a little bit of rhetorical exaggeration, but I still think he meant what he said. So we have to start with that reality, that it's not easy to follow Jesus. To take up your cross and follow Jesus, well, it does mean being prepared to die. I mean, that's take up your cross. It's as simple as that. But it also makes things really complicated for us. But if you're prepared to die, you have to be ready to say goodbye to everything. To family, friends, possessions, comforts, everything that we want to hold on to tightly. Taking up your cross and following Jesus, it means we can't be attached to anything more than to the way of the cross. This is what Jesus says. It's not easy to follow Jesus. Discipleship is challenging. The way of the cross is hard. There's no way to sugarcoat this. It's just what it is. So who then can be saved? That's the question in a similar situation that disciples asked Jesus when he was talking with this rich young ruler who had kept all of the commandments, but didn't feel like he could give up his possessions. And Jesus talked about the camel through the eye of the needle. We preach about that at other times. But it's a similar kind of deal. And So that question, I think, is one that comes up. The disciples say, so who then can be saved? Jesus answered to that, for humans it's impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible. So in that light, I think it's helpful to make a distinction between salvation and discipleship. It's not that these things are completely separate, it's just that there's a distinction. They're not one and the same. Because salvation is God's work. Salvation is God's gift. God chose to come into the world in flesh in Jesus. Because God comes to us, God has broken every barrier between us and God. Whether it's barriers that we've put up because of our sin, or we've created walls between ourselves and God, turned our back on God, whether it's barriers simply because we are so small and God is so great and beyond everything, that there's this great distance and that obviously we're not worthy to be in God's presence just because of that. Whether it's barriers that other people would put up in our place, Jesus comes and God breaks down all those barriers, comes directly to us to be with us in everything. And so we see as Jesus came to all kinds of people in all kinds of situations in the world, he came to people who were outcasts, who were sick, who were suffering, who were alone, who were grieving. And he comes even to be with those who are guilty and suffering and dying. Every kind of situation, whether it's caused by us or caused by someone else, that would cause pain and suffering, God comes there. That's the way of the cross. And it's first God who does it. Jesus comes to us no matter what we've done or someone else has done. And we are not alone, ever alone. No matter how bad we may feel, how low we may feel, how unworthy we may feel, salvation is God's gift, and it is God who comes to us. God always comes to us. That is what the way of the cross is about. Salvation is God's work for us. There are no more barriers because God comes to us. And salvation is also God's work because God brings us beyond the power of death, does not leave us in the place of suffering forever. While God comes to us there so that we are not alone, God brings us out of death into life as Jesus rose from the grave so that we can be with God forever. Salvation is a promise of life, of healing, of restoration, of peace and wholeness. It is the gift of God that God comes to us and God brings us to God's self. The incredible gift of God. So salvation is God's work. It's a gift. Being in the presence of God is something that we could never earn, that we could never be worthy of, that we could never achieve. It's a gift freely given to us by Jesus. We all fail, but God is gracious. God's purpose, God's intention, is to draw everyone into God's saving grace. God's grace overflows. It is more than generous. Whether you or I are good disciples or not good disciples on a given day or all the time, the gift of salvation is for you and it is for me. So salvation is God's work. Discipleship is our work. And to be absolutely clear, a person cannot gain salvation by our work of following Jesus. Salvation is because Jesus comes to us, not because we bring ourselves to him. So when you feel like Jesus saying about what it takes to follow him, when you feel like that's too hard, don't despair. of how hard it is. This isn't a matter of gaining or losing salvation by how good of disciples we are. Now, having said all that, while the grace of God is free for us, it's not cheap. It's not cheap for Jesus. It's costly. It costs him his life. It costs him everything. It's not cheap. It's freely given, but a precious gift. So all Christians, we should want to follow Jesus, not take that gift of salvation for granted, right? Not say, oh, God gives me salvation, yay, just do things however I want to do. We should want to follow Jesus. Following Jesus is about the one who loves us, wanting us to know more of what that love is, wanting us to see him, to follow him, to go where he goes. We put it like this: salvation is a gift like the light of the sun shining onto the world. And discipleship is like taking a lens and focusing that brightness and warmth of the sun and focusing it into a little point where it gets hot, where it can start a fire. A fire that you could use to cook and feed people, or you could gather people around to be warm. The sun is freely given, it just comes. But that lens where it's focused now can also be something where we can use that for the good of others. We could say that lens is Jesus and the way of the cross, where we focus the love of God, the salvation that God gives, where we focus it into action in our lives. But the discipleship that Jesus calls us to, it goes beyond just doing some nice things for other people when it's convenient. I mean, that's nice enough, but lots of people do nice things for other people when it's convenient. Makes us feel good. Everybody does that sometimes. The call of Jesus goes beyond that. Discipleship really is learning how to die to ourselves. It means being willing to give up all the things that we think we need, the comforts that we rely on. The call of Jesus calls us to be able to leave those things behind, not because they're bad. Many things that are good. But we have to be able to let go to some degree because we think, I can't live without this. And maybe we think that we need that more than we think we need the grace of God to live. There are things that can stop us from maybe taking a risk that needs to be taken for the sake of somebody else, because we're afraid of what will happen if we let go or if we step out there. The way of the cross is risky. Going where there is pain is risky. Because what if you get overwhelmed? Or what if you don't know what to do? Believe me, I know. I've been there. I've failed to do as well as I could at times because I didn't deal well with the risk. What if it's awkward? What if I can't do well? What if I don't know what to say? And it's risky to stand up to forces that cause pain. To stand up against things. Paul took a risk when he told Philemon that he should treat Onesimus as a brother instead of as a slave. Christians who protested for civil rights in the 60s were told to calm down and stop rocking the boat. Those who protest for civil rights against abuses today are told the same thing. It's risky to stand up for people who are hurting. It's risky, for real. But Jesus calls us to do this kind of thing because somebody else's life needs help. Your life may literally depend upon it. And it makes us a more whole person than if we just pretend that there's nothing wrong. Can you feel the risk? We can lose time. We can lose comforts. We can even lose relationships. And we can lose possessions by following Jesus in the way of the cross. There's no doubt about that. But taking the step, when you feel the call, taking the step forward into following Jesus, it simply is worth it. Taking those steps of following Jesus, that doesn't gain us salvation. Salvation is freely given to us. Following Jesus is worth it because it's a way where someone who needs good news, who really needs help, who really needs someone to be there, has it. Because we take the step out into that risk. Even if it costs us something. Following Jesus is worth it because we learn that we can trust God's gift of life, that we don't create our own life, that we don't sustain it, that all those things that we want to hold on to so tightly, you know, those relationships can still be there. People who follow Jesus find that they have what they need. We can trust in that gift of life and that gift of God. And we'll falter in our discipleship. We'll stumble on the path. We'll fail. The same way the first disciples that Jesus called did. How many times did Peter get it wrong and even deny Jesus at his trial? It's not a matter that we have to get it perfectly. It's a matter of coming along the way and learning what God's love is about. Coming along the way and learning, and Peter learned to be more bold and to step out for other people along the way. We can start imagining what it is to be more free to follow Jesus, to respond more readily when we feel a call. We can think about, I feel like something is getting in my way. What's that about? What am I afraid of? What don't I want to let go of? Maybe I can let go. What could it mean that Jesus who died and rose from the grave is right there? If he's calling us, he's calling us to see his presence, to see that he's right there with us, right ahead of us, leading the way. What could it mean to follow him? Amen. In the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen.
We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten and not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. We pray, O Lord, for your church, for all people who have been called, who have heard your good news. May we all continue to step forward in following you, to follow in the way of the cross, to bring good news to all people. In your name, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for all who suffer from hunger, from disasters, from exposure to the elements, from those who are oppressed, those who suffer from violence, for those caught in war, for those trying to find freedom and hope, for those who don't have work or not enough work, for those who are abused and neglected, all who cry out for hope and for help, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
prayer. Lord, we pray for all who need healing. Today, remember the needs of Martin and Irene, Dixie, Lee, Julia, Marilyn, Barb, Don, Dorothy, Lori, Pat, Melissa, Herb, Tim, Pat, Pauline, Steve, Rosemary, Joyce, Pam, Nancy, Murray, and all for whom we pray. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks, Lord, for the witness of all who have gone before. Ask that you strengthen us in faith to look forward to being united with them in your great heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Mark, peace be with you. Bruce, peace be with you. Lord, peace be with you.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Merciful God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of him who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Mighty and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and the suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that by this Holy Communion we may know the unity that we share with all of your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you.
May we stand and receive the blessing of Christ's table. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let's pray. Almighty God, you provide the true bread from heaven, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant that we who receive the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Thank you.
peace serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Your hair.